Welcome back to Oxtools, I'm Tom. So this previous episode of Meatloaf got too big, so we had to break up the subjects a little bit. And this is a follow-on to Meatloaf 23, I think. And so we are going to show this tailstock tool that I had mentioned. We're going to look at some flea market finds, a bunch of tools that we got at the flea market, and some boxes showed up in the mail. One of them is from our good friend Keith Fenner at Turnright Machine Works, and I got my my Turnright Machine Works swag on here, you can see. And be sure to stay tuned because I got something special in a little later on in this video for you, Keith. Anyway, let's get to it. Okay, let's look at some flea market finds here. Let's see, I got a bunch of stuff here, so probably break this up into a couple segments. Some of these are real simple, we'll just go through them real quick. Drill index, not too far off, got most of them in there, $3. Okay, case is kind of beat up, but serviceable. This is kind of cool. This is a Victor flow meter here. Okay, now the gauge is kind of chowdered, but that's a pretty easy thing to fix. So what I look for is to see if this is messed up, and this seems to all work. Anyway, these are fairly expensive. This was $2, okay? So I'll get a new gauge for this and maybe use Scout Crafter's technique for shining this plastic up here, get some of these scratches out of there so you can read it a little easier, and see if we can get that back in service, okay? All right, so next one. So that same guy had a bunch of welding stuff. This is pretty cool, but here's a cutting tip. This looks like a standard Victor cutting tip, and it's a number 4, which is a pretty big one, so you could probably cut something like this table or close to it with that one. Maybe not quite that thick, but it's in good shape. It's not all beat to snot, and these are fairly expensive. This is a, I don't know, no-name brand, but it looks pretty good. So that was $2. Okay, along with this. Let's see if I can pop this clip off of here. This is called a pipe wrap. And basically, it's a wrap, welders and fitters wrap around, and you can do all kinds of, let me flip it around here, you can do, it's got all kinds of info on it, and you can go around a pipe, and you can do all kinds of layouts, you know, for miter cuts and all kinds of stuff. And you can also just trace a line around the edge. In fact, it looks like somebody's done that with a Sharpie or something for cutting off a tube or a pipe. I used to have one of these, but I don't know where it went, but I got another one now. This one's a little crispy, but you can see it's kind of reinforced, so they're pretty tough. Anyway, $2 for that. Actually, Mrs. Ox spotted that, and because she's comes from the pipe trades. And she saw that and goes, "Hey, look at that pipe wrap." And I said, "Oh, good spot." So we ended up getting it. I'll wind that up later. Okay. So there's that. So not far from there was these three items here. And this is a Williams, and this is a double box of the 7⅜. Like I said, I've just been picking these up when I see them, especially when they're $2. Okay. This is kind of an interesting bit here. There's no name on it, but it looks like it's for unscrewing some kind of slotted bungs, maybe from a drum or a barrel or something, and they're oriented differently. It's pretty nicely made, and I'll clean it up a little bit. Don't know what I'll use it for, but for $2, I was like, meh. You know, I made a little package out of this thing here, so $2, $4, $6. For all of these. Like I said, I don't know what that is per se there. It's got a little number on it, but I don't know. I haven't bothered to look it up. Okay, so a little... who is it? It's got the little crown here. I can't remember who that is. It's a number 15 tap wrench here. And, you know, it's in pretty good shape. I did notice it's got a little crack there, but it probably works fine even with that. So anyway, $2, so hey, whatever. Okay, next one. Next one's kind of an interesting thing. I started with that. So it's a pair of calipers, and these are Union. Nothing spectacular about those. But what I did was, the guy had some other stuff that was very interesting. I wanted to kind of get calibrated with him to see what kind of prices he had. So I asked about this, and he said $2. And I went, okay, so his prices seem to be okay. So then what I did is, I immediately pounced on the stuff that I was interested in. And let's pull it all out here. It kind of all goes together here. It just keeps going and going here. It gets better and better. Was that part of it? No, that wasn't part of it. And I think that is it. Okay. Yeah, that was... Okay, so that was it. So I started with this, and he said $2. I said, oh, okay. So then I gathered up all this other stuff here, and we'll talk about each one real quick here, and got a price for the whole thing. But let's talk about them first. So there's another pair of calipers. These are called hermaphrodite calipers, and they have one leg that's a scriber leg and one leg that's a caliper leg, and you can use these for scribing a line parallel to an edge. Now these are neat because they have the fine adjust mechanism on them here, and none of this, and it's a sterret, and none of the sterret knobs are missing or the little ball, so all the bits are here. And then this one has, and I don't have a pair like this, it has a sliding thing, so if you have different height items, well that's probably too much there, but if you have different height items, you can adjust the leg length. Okay, so all the bits are there. So that's pretty cool. These are just pin spanners here. And these are Williams. But, you know, these are good if you have like grinding disc things to remove. And these have a couple of different pin sizes, so I jumped on those. This one's got some grind marks on it, but still good. Okay. All right, so this is a rule clamp. And the way that...
Hey Doug, what's up, bub?
The way this works is it'll fit on a combination square, like so. And I don't have another. Oh yeah, I do have another rule here. And what you can do with this one that's kind of cool. Let's open this up. Should have prepared a little better here, but I can demo this. My dog is licking my leg right now. So what you can do with this one is you can position another ruler at 90 degrees to another one, so you can use this like a big depth gauge if you want, something like that. So you got some big span you got to get across, right? And then you can probe down into the nether regions there. Anyway, so it's just a 90 degree rule clamp. I already have one of these, but they're kind of expensive, so I went ahead and put it in my pile and picked it up. And then, oh, well, let's talk about that. It's a little Union tool, 3/4 inch, 4R graduation ruler. It says Malone, L.A. L.A. Malone, I don't know. So anyway, it's a guy's name, something like that. All right, so we talked about that. Now this, Adam's probably kind of interested in this thing here. What it is it's a level, and we've been talking about levels, and this is a little 4 inch. But it's missing the vial, unfortunately. But all the other stuff's here. So if I find a good bubble with eyes on it, or maybe I'll buy one from Sterrett, I don't know, that'll go back together. But the base looks pretty good. And it's the newer one with the involute groove in it, as opposed to the just plain round groove. Okay, there's that. You know, here's a standard combination square. It's a Sterrett. And I always look for these knobs. So if I'm looking on the ground and I see this style of knob, I go ahead and just pick it up and look at it and make sure. Missing the scribe, but it's got a satin chrome blade, number four graduation blade. So that this will probably go to somebody else here. So I have a bunch of combination squares. And then the center head too. So let's put that together. So those kind of live together. Gosh, you can never do that fast when you're on camera, right? All right, what's going on here? You know, I've only done this 100,000 times, right, in my life, so. Okay, anyway, so a combination set. Now this is one of the things I was really excited about because I've always wanted one of these. And it's just a little square. I mean, it's just flat, but I know I wanted one of these and I looked at how much they were and they were pretty expensive. So I bought a cheap one and I've never been satisfied with it, but I finally ended up with one. It's pretty nice. Anyway, it's just a little tiny carpenter square made by Sterrett, number 21. Anyway, I like it. So this makes it all worthwhile, this whole pile here that I got. So price for all this stuff here, all this stuff was $30, okay, which is a really good deal, okay? I mean, that's worth $30 right there. That's worth probably $30. It's in great shape, okay? I would have paid $30 for that, okay? So that just kind of sets the scale there. So this was pretty good. So when you're talking to these guys, you know, get calibrated, you know, and then so if you like what you hear, then make a pile, and generally you get a better price on a group of items than you do just piecing them out one by one. So you can always make a pile, and if you don't like the price, you can take something out and do that, and or negotiate from that point, you know. And you know, it's got to be right for both parties too. So the best negotiation is when both parties leave a little bit annoyed, so you know it was the right price at that point. Okay, so we're working on the clip right now. And I actually found some stainless steel that we're going to use for this thing. And so we're going to bend these up. So we're going to shear some little strips. We're going to punch a couple holes in there and form these up in kind of a interesting way because my little Diacro brake isn't quite ready yet. So let's go over to the shear. I've already calculated the blank length here. They're 1 inch wide this way, and then I worked out the length from the AutoCAD layout. And here's the inside dimension, 1.6. Inside is 1.0 here, and then the distance from the inside to the hole is 0.6. So if I add all that up, I get a blank length of about 4.2 inches. So let's go cut a piece. All right, so we're here on the little Diacro shear here, and I got some 20,000ths stainless shim stock, which should work pretty good for this. So what I want to do first is lop a strip off of the right width, which is 1 inch. I'm just going to set my calipers, and I'm going to set this little depth stop because this doesn't have a back gauge on it, but I can reach up from the back and use this to gauge on the back side, like so. Set that aside. So I'm just going to come up from behind here. I'm going to just push this up until it. Hit something. There we go. That. Okay, hold that down. And then the hold down will come down and pinch it. And there's something here. right? That ain't an inch. What did I do? I must have been up against something that I shouldn't have been. Okay, let's try that again. Not the most convenient way to do this. Oh, I think I know what it hit. I think it hit the screw, not the. That feels better. Okay. Yeah, let's see a bunch of that. Hey, yeah, that's what it did. Well, that's the Braille method, right? Okay, that looks a lot better. Let's see what we got here. Okay, I'd call that pretty close to an inch, all right? Okay, it's got a little taper to it, but that's not gonna hurt us. Okay, so now I'm going to get that out of the way. My test piece, we'll call that the test piece. Now I want to cut a piece 4.2 inches long, which is our blank length. So I'm going to do the Sharpie dicum here. Just to get it in the right place here. You know, in a normal shear, you'd have a back gauge or something like that, and you would okay. So I got a nice little scribe line there that I can barely see. Doing too good today, so let's do that again. Thinking about that camera too much. Boston. Alright, set the calipers for 4.2. That's a good start, right? Well, at least it was too long. Much. It's just a little trim now. All right, let's try. Okay. Oh, better. Yeah, we're about 10 thousandths long, which is probably fine, so. Okay, so let's go do some layout on this bit and punch some holes, and then we'll do a little forming. Okay, let's start out by... So I'm using a different pair of calipers here. These particular ones, these are some older ones that I have, but they have carbide tips on them, which is kind of nice for doing kind of scratch layout like this. Because the carbide leaves a nice mark. This stuff is kind of thin. Okay, so that's the center. And then it's 1 inch wide, so we'll go halfway. So I'm just using these kind of like a hermaphrodite calipers. Center pop. Okay, I like it. Ooh, that's a little mark on my table. Should probably put it on somewhere. Okay. Then we're gonna lay out the bend lines. Okay. which are 1.6 from the ends. Hopefully I got some Sharpie there, yep. Turn around. Bastard. you don't want to Sharpie the whole damn thing, right? But you kind of end up doing that anyway. Okay, bend line. So this should be about an inch between those. Yep. Okay. And then the last bit is the hole, which is going to be it's 0.6 off of that. Is that right? 0.6 off of the bend. So let me double check that. So we mark it 1 inch, yeah, that's right. Marked it in 1 inch. Bad. Did it again? Oh, hey, that one works. A little more. See, I should have just colored the whole damn thing in. Okay, and then halfway. These will be in the center, these holes. All right. Do a little center punch in there. And we'll jump over to the Rotex. Okay. Jump over to the Rotex and we'll smack some holes in it. Okay, so we got two different size holes here, so I gotta be careful. So this one is for an 8/32, and then this is for the quarter inch rod here. So I'm gonna go ahead and pop. I'm on 3/16 here, so I'm just gonna go ahead and see. Try not to block the camera there, Mr. Wizard. We'll find the center. Okay, there's a hole. Now we'll change it to do the, let's do the upper one first. So we're a quarter inch, and that's a D. So we set the bottom. So these are independent here, so you gotta make sure you're on the right, where you think you are. Okay. Okay. This stuff punches real nice because it's hard. Trying to find the, there it is. Trying to find the, these have a little tit on the bottom that you locate in the center punch. Okay, so let's, we're gonna do a little curving on that to dress them up, and then we'll bend them up. Okay, so here's what we're bending here. I bent one up already, and so I'll show you how we do the bends on that. And then so let's see if I have that handy. The idea is the rod goes through here, and you see it doesn't want to line up, but if I squeeze it, it will line up. And I'm gonna try this as opposed to having that spring in there, and see if I can get that distance correct enough. Anyway, so you can see that locks, but I can just move it when I squeeze these a little bit, and it takes a nice lock. So it's more than enough to support that shelf, but it instantly releases and I can move it around. Now, if you just don't squeeze it too hard, I think it'll work fine. Okay, so let's go ahead and bend that one up. Welcome to Turn Right Machine Works. My name is Keith. Today we have a submarine propeller with 8 blades on it, and we're going to turn the taper and cut a key and fit that taper to the prop. It weighs 15 tons, but we'll be able to squeeze it in the lathe and bore that taper and fit that shaft. So let's get out there and get her done. Okay, next ones are a couple small items here. So I think I mentioned this before. Whenever I see these, I always pick them up. You know, they're a quarter, a dollar, whatever they are. This was $2 for $6. This is a long blue point screw starter here. I don't have a flathead screw to show you, but you can reach down into little places, and this one's kind of got a bendy shank on it, so you can crank screws in. I don't think I have one this long, but that'll go in the kit. Don't really need any more carbide burrs. I'm pretty flush on those. This is SGS. I don't think it's ever been used. For $2, I'm just not going to leave it laying there, okay? And then here's a half-inch 14 pipe tap that's, once again, probably never been used. And, you know, for $2, I'm not gonna mess around. Okay, so then we got a couple other things coming up here. So let me snag those, and we'll keep going. Okay, so this next one here, this is the last thing I got at the flea market. This particular one, and if you see a box like this laying on the ground, go take a look at it. What's in here is a big indicator, and this is probably the longest travel dial indicator that I've ever actually seen. This is 4 inches of travel here, and it seems to operate fine. The crystal, you know, I'm jinxed on crystals here. The crystal was popping out of the bezel, but I actually managed to get it back in there, so it's happy again, and it operates fine now. And so we're going to look at some of the accessories here, and we'll see if you guys can figure out what this person was doing. Anyway, it operates smoothly through its whole range here. It's not sticky at all. Now this one, it's got a pretty good spring in it. Got to be careful. This could put your eye out. Doink. Okay. So if you're not careful, this one will put the hurt on you. And it had this little plastic sleeve on it. I don't quite. It fits real nice. I don't know if this came from Sterrett or what, but it's a little. I don't know. It's a little short. It doesn't really protect this from getting bent or anything. But anyway, it's on there. So it's got an Allen wrench, and then it's got this, I don't know what the hell that is, a little cut off piece of garbage there. I don't know why, that's definitely not Sterrett. But then it's got this. So this started to clue me in a little bit as to what they might have been using this for. Okay, and this is, I believe this is part of a puller here, kind of like those Plum pullers I showed. But then it's got this bolt with a hole drilled off center in it in a bad way. What I think they were using this for is measuring the stroke of an engine. So this would span across the cylinder, and then they could put this on top of the piston, and then you know, maybe put a couple bolts in that to hold it down to the block, and lock the indicator in, and then check the stroke there. So this is coming out of there. That's coming out. That's coming out. And this will stay in the box. It's just, oh, it's inspection tag here. Marie Winchester inspected this. So so anyway, that. So the guy worked me on this deal here. Okay. He told me what he wanted for it. I offered him less, and then he came back with another price, and then I agreed. So we started out at $35, and so I picked it up, and I tried, and I looked at it, and I said, "Well, would you take 30 for it?" And he goes, "No, 33." And I go, "Okay." So I bought it, $33. Now, Adam Booth is, he's already seen this, and he's got some interest in this thing. Adam doesn't have a DRO on his lathe, and this could be a, until he fires up his checkbook and buys a DRO, this could be a really good addition to his lathe, and that he could just put this on a magnet, and now he's got a 4-inch range that he can turn in the Z-axis, that he can turn really accurate shoulders and whatnot on there, okay? So Adam's expressed some interest in this, and so this is probably gonna go out to Florida and then visit with Adam out there. So anyway, Adam, I don't think you want that stuff, so I'm just gonna leave that out of there, and I don't know what I'm gonna do with that. I'll take a look at it a little closer. Anyway, so that was the big cool find there at the flea market, so. Okay, so the next one here, this comes from our buddy Stan down in Southern California, and his channel is Shaden HKW, and Stan visited the shop up here, and now he sent me a box here, and he said, hey, open that on camera and tell me if you know what it is. So you can see, Stan, that I haven't opened this up, so hopefully this isn't anything embarrassing in here. We're gonna open that up, see what we got here. Uh-oh, yikes. I'm supposed to identify this thing. He said, see if you can identify this thing. What the hell is that? Well, it looks like some kind of solenoid thing. Go figure. So he says, you probably already have one. I'm like, really? Okay. All right, let's see here. Let's see what the heck this thing is here. Oh, maybe it's a... No, I don't know. Magnetizer? Well, it's nicely wrapped up here. Assembled in Mexico. Interesting. Well, it certainly looks like a solenoid thing here. It's got a button. I don't know. And then it's got a couple of screws to mount it to something. I don't know. It looks like part of a some kind of solenoid setup here. Dayton Electric, huh? Dayton Electric. Oh, is this a... maybe it's a switch. No. There's no contacts here. I don't know. Stan, you got me on this one. I'm not sure what this is. This, I don't know, bud. You're gonna have to clue me in a little bit. You got me stumped on that one. So, I'll tell you what, I'm gonna look it up and then I'll tell you what it is. Anyway, Stan, once I figure it out, I'll let you know if I like it or not. Okay, thanks for the goodies. Okay, so next one here. So it comes from Don Cossett up in Oregon. And Don's got a channel, so be sure to check out Don's channel. He's working out in the middle of nowhere out there, and he's got a lathe and a mill, and he does some cool stuff out in his shop. And anyway, he saw me farting around with packing a syringe full of grease, so he felt sorry for me, so he sent me this this little mini grease gun, and full of a small amount of weasel snot. Okay, so we'll clean that out, and we'll load this up with some different grease, or maybe that blue grease I was using. Anyway, thanks for the grease gun. These are pretty cool because you can fill those little ball depress oilers too. And let's see if we can make this thing. Okay, it's empty. And then he sent me this thing here, and I'm not quite sure what this is. It's some kind of funny rag or something like that. I'm not quite sure what this is used for. Maybe that was laying on that. I don't know. Anyway, so I'm not quite clear what this is here. 100% cotton, made in China. Hey, it's got a little, what is it? Oh, it's an elephant. It's a little elephant on there. So, I don't know, it's an elephant rag or something like that. Oh, wait, I know what this is. It's a dog collar. You put this on your dog, right? You put this on your dog, and then, so it's like a hippie dog collar, that's what it is. Or wait a second, I don't know. I'll have to look that one up too. Anyway, thanks Don, appreciate the gifts. And we'll get this loaded up with some fresh grease, clean out the weasel snot, and put it to use. Thank you very much, my friend. Okay, so next one comes to me from my mom and dad. And they went to some little estate sale out where they live, and they picked up a couple little items they picked them up as mystery tools to see if I could figure out what they were, okay? Well, this one, I knew what this one was right out of the gate. This is a tool for adjusting old-style brakes. And these are kind of handy, actually. I just used one the other day to pull a gear off, because I could reach in there behind there and pull a gear off. It worked out pretty good. I'm glad I had two of them. But anyway, that's a tool for adjusting brakes. So now, the more interesting one is this crazy looking thing here, okay? Now I'm not gonna tell you, it's got a number on the handle here, and I've already looked it up because it stumped me. Oh, that's the other thing. That's spring loaded. And it's got about, I don't know, inch and a half of travel, something like that. So it's got little barbs, and it's got this kind of sharpened little edge here, and these two little barbs, like it's for cutting something or turning something. I don't quite know what. Well, actually I do know what, because but I'm gonna let you guys kick in your ideas there, okay? And see what you think that is. Sort of like what Tubal Cain does with mystery tools. And so go ahead and throw a comment up and see if your guess is right. And anyway, check that out. It's kind of a trippy tool there, all right? So that was for Mom and Dad. Thanks, Mom and Dad. Appreciate that. And whoever guesses what this is, I'll let them know, and we'll go from there, all right? So you guys might remember this from a previous tool review here. I got this at that estate sale that I went to a while back. And I picked it up. It was in a bag, and I picked it up, and I thought I knew what it was, and what brand it was, and I just bought it. It's called a bench block, and it's used for doing assembly or whatever, where you have to. This is kind of big, but where you have to knock pins through something or hold something round while you work on it or whatever, things like that. And then this one, it's actually fairly nicely made. It's got good knurling on it. Machine work looks pretty good. The groove is a little bit rough. They didn't grind the groove. And when I flipped it over, I saw that it was an offshore brand there, okay? So I guess I was slightly disappointed, but it's still actually a pretty nice bench block, okay? Well, somebody took pity on me. And actually, he's an old friend back from my metal shaping days when I was involved with the metal shapers on the internet. And he has a company down in Southern California called PTC Instruments. His name's John, and they make instruments for measuring durometers of rubbers and other things. So he's got a company. He's been doing that for a million years. And he's into metal work, sheet metal shaping and machine work and fabrication. And his wife does some artwork and stuff like that. Anyway, I've known him for a long time. And I sent him some drawings of some stuff that he wanted to do. And as a kind of a thank you, what he did is he sent me a bench block. Now, this one happens, this is a Starrett bench block, okay, and it's a number 129. And, but what I wanted to show is I just kind of wanted to compare them here. So, as you can see, these guys very, very carefully copied the original, okay. They did a pretty good job. And, I mean, down to, let's see. Oh, yeah, they get the, okay, I thought the holes even were oriented properly here. Well, they kind of are. Okay, so yeah, I mean, it's a spitting image of it, right? There's that hole, little hole, little hole, little hole, bigger hole, okay? And then now this has got a little crisper edge here on it, and the groove is just a little nicer. But other than that, they're really close. Now, here's the other thing here is they used a raised band to knurl, which I kind of like, actually, because it gives you a little edge when you pick it up, okay, where this one's smooth. You know, no slight against either one of these guys. Actually, they're both kind of nice. But the knurling's basically almost the same diameter as the body of this. Now, what I really like about this one is it says Fire Control Lab. Okay, so that's the kind of stuff I like. So this came out of somebody that did fire suppression system or missile launch calibration or who knows what, but it just kind of fires up your imagination, the Fire Control Lab. So it's kind of neat. And this doesn't say anything on it, although it looks unused. Now, one thing I noticed, I put them together. This has been surface ground, but they didn't bother to demagnetize it. So it's got a little bit of, let's see if this is, yeah. Oop, maybe that's not steel. That's tempered, yeah, okay. It should be steel. Well, I noticed it had a, I gotta find something else here that's magnetic. Okay, well, I don't have anything within reach here that's magnetic. But when I put it together with this one here, it's got a little bit of grab. So this one's got a little bit of residual magnetism in it. This one's pretty good here. So anyway, this is going to go in the trade bucket over there, and this one will go in because this one, you know, frankly, I kind of like this one. I don't know, I like them both actually. But anyway, this one's gonna go in the trade bucket. I'm gonna keep this one because I really like this Fire Control Lab. So, John, thank you very much. Appreciate the little gift, and be sure to show us your comparator when you get that thing built. So anyway, thank you. Okay, so what we're gonna do here is we're gonna use the Kurt Weiss as our bending brake since my Diacro finger brake isn't ready yet. But we're gonna use one of the fingers off of the brake, which is a little different there. And what we're gonna do is, this will be our brake here like so, which is kind of nice because this holds it square. And then we're gonna clamp this like so. And I'm gonna do it like that, I think. Okay. Now I gotta get my big head in there and get the world lined up here. Put my scribe line there, okay. So that's the first bend. Okay, and the way I'm going to do that, I'm just going to tap it around with my little hammer here. You guys know how much I like hammers. So you see I'm holding it so that it doesn't flap. All right, and then I had already bent the other one, so I'm just using that as an angle gauge. Let's see what we got here. Oops. Now, that's actually a little too far. Come back, okay. Okay, I like it. That's the first bend. Now we'll pop that out and we'll put this back in. Can I see my scrap line? Yeah. Barely. Nice scrap line there, Tom. Well, hopefully this gets it. Clamp that. Okay. And I'm going to pull on that a little bit. Hopefully you can see that. light. And it's pretty close. Yeah, close enough for what we're doing.
Okay.
All right, there it is. So let's see. See how it does here. I think that one needs. Let's see how they are opened up here. I think, okay, so this one's a little overbent, but that's easy enough to fix and this thin stuff. Okay, that's better. I just kind of sprung it by hand there. All right, so let's go put it together and see how that works. Okay, so I put it all together off camera just because I didn't want to film me fumbling around with it. Anyway, it seems to work fine. So it goes up. And it goes, well, it goes up, and it goes down. It goes up, and it goes down. Okay, so here's the idea here, guys. So here's the pipettes. They drop in like so. And I don't know if you can see it, but they're projecting out the bottom here, like so. And then we have different height bottles, okay? So this would be for this one here, like so, okay? And then if we want to run one of the taller ones, we can stick one of those under there instead. Oh, hey, got it just right. Okay. Now, it feels like it could use a little bit of weight, but, you know, just to make it easier to adjust, oops, you know, if the base was weighted a little bit more. But I think it works fine. Yeah, it's starting to work. Yeah, there's a spot you can grab these just right where it slides real easy. So, tall bottle, small bottle, right? Anyway, and then the shelf holds plenty of weight. There's what it looks like on the ends. I guess I gotta take some of that Sharpie off. Okay. Anyway, I think that came out pretty good. And so give it to Dad and let him slather solvent all over it and see how it performs. Anyway, pipette rack is done, and thanks for watching, guys.